This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Well, today on Dreamland, we're going to do something we literally have never done before. I don't think many people have. I came across a guy, too, actually, him and his wife, and it's only going to be him on the show, who are experts in, of all things, coma and the near-death experience. And I thought, what is that about? Well, we're going to find out, because we're going to be talking today to none other than Alan Pierce, who is the co-author of this fascinating book, Coma and the Near-Death Experience, The Beautiful, Disturbing, and Dangerous World of the Unconscious. He's a journalist, he's a broadcaster, a former BBC correspondent. He's the author of a number of other books. He has contributed to the Time Magazine, to the Sunday Times of London. Beverly, his wife, is a former private investigator who works, interestingly enough, as an aromatherapist now. They live in France. Either that's wonderful and lucky or not, depending on what part of France you're in.
Yeah, it depends how you want to analyze it. Parts of it are wonderful.
You decided to write a book about coma. And I thought to myself, this is fascinating, because my wife was in a coma for 6 weeks after her brain bleed in 2004. She had a near-death experience during the coma too. So this is something I want to learn more about. What inspired you to write a book about coma?
Well, I never set out to write a book about coma. What happened was, I'm a journalist and I'm always asking questions. And early on in COVID, I was watching the evening news, and yet more and more people are being placed into medically induced comas. And I thought, that's interesting. How does that work? And how does that benefit anyone? So I just had to look. And the official explanation goes like this, that deep sedation, prolonged deep sedation, i.e. coma, has been a critical part of critical care for the past 50 years, and that it provides the deepest form of sleep, a restorative form of sleep that allows the body to rest as best it can, and that the drugs and nature do what they can. During COVID, especially, doctors would say that no patient on the mechanical ventilator can tolerate that whilst being conscious. People just fight the vent. And they also say that any events within coma just can't be there. They have to be a false memory or hallucination, because effectively the brain is offline. It's a bit like, say, having a desktop computer, unplugging it from the wall and expecting it to work in some way. It won't. The brain is now thoroughly offline. So everything they tell you, that it's sleep, it's restorative rest, you can't do it on you have to be sedated on the ventilator, and the thing should be a blank. All of that turns out to be wrong, every bit of it. Where would you like to go from there, Whitley?
Yeah, because I could not agree with you more. My wife had a near-death experience during her coma. But I want to, before we go on, I want to continue to set a little bit of stage. You gathered the information. The book's full of experiences. Can you tell us how you found coma survivors and where they were and what they were like?
Well, after listening to the medical explanation, I never wanted just to take, you know, the first answer as fact. So I just had to look a little further. So it seemed to me the best people to speak to would be the eyewitnesses, people who've been through coma themselves. It took me a while, but funny enough, on Facebook, there are a number of groups. The one in particular that allowed me entry was the Coma Survivors Group. And I sat in the shadows, as it were, and I watched people posting. And comas are supposed to be a blank. Well, people were recounting all sorts of things, but they were using medical terms such as delirium, hallucination, false memory, coma dreams. None of those things can actually happen. You can't hallucinate whilst unconscious. You can't be delirious whilst unconscious. So they were using all the wrong terms. The other thing that got me was that they all seem to have remarkably similar ailments. For example, extreme pain and muscle ache, inability to sleep because of the fear of going back to the very depths of hell, which we can talk about in a while. Balance, shocking memory loss, and just an all-round just inability to live life to the full the way they had before coma. So suddenly I'm seeing alarm bells ringing, and I'm wondering, how is it that no one else has seen these before we came along? I then managed to talk to individual coma survivors, and it's not an easy thing, because what people experience within coma, when they come out of it, no one's explained to them what they've been through. So invariably they think they've gone mad. Now, it could be they, like your wife Anne, had an NDE, and it may have been a beautiful thing which could have given them a positive life experience. However, without any guidance, they can still think they're mad. Equally, events within coma, and we can talk about the different types, sometimes they're horrendous and people truly think they've gone mad, so they don't even tell their nearest and dearest. So in order to get people to talk to me, we had to speak for many cases for months at a time, and I told them the things I was finding out, and then bit by bit people would open up to me, and the stories they told me, which are in the book, which form a large part of the book, are beyond anything, beyond the human imagination. No scriptwriter could ever make the stuff up. It is so off the scale.
Well, I have read the book, and I am thinking, Anne had an NDE during her coma that changed her life completely. After that, she was a different person. In a good way. And it opened the door in her to another world. And she stayed like that after she came out of the coma. She didn't have any lasting memory loss or anything like that. She came back pretty much completely. But then years later, she began to die of a brain tumor. And began to ask me to do strange things, like memorize a certain poem, Song of the Wandering Angus. And after she passed on, it turned out that she had been planning from the January of 2015 until August of 2015 when she died, her return. She knew how to do it. I mean, isn't that amazing? I mean, and are we not talking about people who come to the edge? You've got a lot to say, so I'll just shut up.
Oh, well, I can fully understand this. I've spoken to people who have died, clinically died, been resuscitated within the intensive care unit, sometimes, in one case, four times. They have died and they have come back. And a number of them have had the classic near-death experience. And once you've seen that, you know life goes on. You just know. There's no two ways about it. It's abundantly self-evident. And I dare say this is what Anne felt. And she also, when she was there, you learn things. You don't always have the ability to come back with this knowledge that you do learn. But you know that you've learned something. Something vital, something important about the meaning of life and why we're here. I very much imagine that this is what Anne saw on the other side.
Well, she didn't, on the other side, Anne being Anne, everything was always very practical and down to earth. What she felt she'd seen on the other side was found herself in what looked to her like a bus station. And there were a lot of people sitting around with bags and suitcases and stuff. And her lesson that she had brought back from that was that And she was told, you can go on or you can go back. And she chose to come back because her family wasn't finished. Her son and his fiance weren't married and they didn't have children. They weren't married yet. They didn't have children. And one of the first things she did when she came out of ICU psychosis was she said, we've got to get to my son. We've got to get this family going. And that's why she came back, to be the grandmother and the head of the family. And she did that.
It's interesting. She was at a bus station, a terminus.
Yeah, well, that's right. Well, the bus station, it's a terminus, exactly. And the people had all of these burdens. And she, when she came back, her lesson was to everyone who would listen to her, you've got to put those down in this life, because you can't put them down once you're over there. Then you're going to have to come back. So put your burdens down, she said. She was a spiritual master, but not a pretentious one. She was a very unpretentious, down-to-earth spiritual master, but the real deal for sure. And she could help you.
Can I just say, she was able to interpret that because of that knowledge, wasn't she?
Of course. Yes, exactly.
Whereas the majority of people in coma have events like that, and I'm going to speculate that Anne's experience was more real than real, with ultra clarity, that people who experience that honestly think they've gone mad, because there's no point of reference. No one gives you a pamphlet at the end of this.
Well, tell us some of the stories. Just choose one. And there are a lot of stories of this experience of thinking that you've gone mad, which never occurred to Anne at all. But give us an example of a coma witness. I don't know which story to pick.
Okay. I mean, they form sort of different groups. Some are like NDEs, as we generally think of an NDE. Some are so appallingly dark. Others involve alternate lives. Now, for example, if you have, past life regression, you go back and maybe you witness that life, or you are aware of it, but you're not living it minute by minute. Some people within coma are having alternate lives that span decades. They live them minute by minute. They have all the normal things one expects in life. They hold down jobs, they get married, they have kids, they go on vacation, they live life to the full. And then in one particular instance, Nick in the book was living this life. It started to get a bit stressful. I think he was having a heart attack, collapsed, woke up. When he opened his eyes, the people around him, his family, were not his family. He didn't recognize any of them. And he had another family in this other life. And it took him a long time to come to terms with which was real, the one he's in now or the one he's just left. And he seriously thought he was mad. And as he said to me, my family wouldn't come out and say so, but they thought I'd gone insane.
Did this continue for a while after the coma? Because when Anne first woke up from ICU psychosis, which she went through big time, when she was first disintubated, they asked her name, and she remembered her name. Then they asked her, who is this man standing here? And she looks at me and she says, I have no idea. And I couldn't tell, is she joking or not? And then the nurse said, this is your husband, Whitley. And she said, that can't be my husband. I'd never marry a man that ugly.
Thanks for sharing that.
But then she proceeded to descend into ICU psychosis. And I guess the question is, those who have these terrible experiences during the coma, can you characterize it? Because she only had the NDE, and it was like everything that happened with Anne, it was a teaching tool. Anne was the best teacher in the world. But tell us some of these stories that, you know, people have alternate lives. Do you think they really have those lives?
No, I have no way of proving this one. I've managed to prove a whole bunch of things in the book.
Yes,
I don't think we'll ever be able to prove. If anything, I think they're having past lives. They're going back and experiencing past lives. They're never set in the future. They're never actually set in the now. Sometimes they go back so far. One guy told me he looked really good in a Georgian wig. So people are in all these different times. And in the case of Nick, the story I just told, he was reliving his time in the 1960s and 1970s in Midwest America. He even got called up for an alternate Southeast Asian war and did a combat tour there within his coma. Other people have told me, for example, there's a composer in the book, Stephen Watkins. Within his coma, he was spending most of his time in the Caribbean, having a very nice time. And he defines himself as a musician, as a composer. And he was precisely that there. And he says, in this world, he's very keen on sailing. And he was doing a lot of that there. And it is so strange. So these are real lives. Whether that was an alternate life, whether that was an idealized life that he somehow his mind conjured up. These things I don't think we'll be able to explain. When people are placed into a coma, it's not as if there's a one-size-fits-all coma tablet. It's different things for different people. All sorts of things about a person will make their reaction to the coma different. Some people will just bubble beneath the surface. And the way of measuring the depth of coma is virtually primitive. It's not even like a thermometer where you can read a number. It's almost guesswork. So some people who they think they've dosed up heavily are just floating beneath the surface. They're paralyzed. They're aware of virtually everything around them in real time. They can't even blink or scream. Sometimes people are completely in the dark with full consciousness, no feeling, nothing, just a brain, as it were, or a mind in complete and utter darkness. In the book, there's the story of a 15-year-old girl who found herself after a road accident stuck like this. And she's just saying, where's my mummy? Why doesn't my mummy come and wake me up? This is ridiculous. I've been sleeping far too long. Then you can go slightly deeper where the events around you within the hospital start weaving into these nightmarish events. So the very kind doctors and nurses who are really trying to save your life, your mind is portraying them as murderers and torturers. And that just gives people the most abject horrors. And when people have small operations or having their teeth cleaned, it's perceived as some ghastly torture. So there's a whole range. And on top of that, there's the beautiful ones where people are literally in heaven. But it varies from person to person.
Now, it's interesting. My question, and this was a question I wondered whether I should ask or not, because you don't explore it directly in the book. Why is there this difference? Some people have absolutely horrendous experiences in coma, and then there are some beautiful stories in here.
Yeah, I don't think anyone can really explain that.
No.
You know, one guy, his name is Rory. He's a Brit. He was in an horrific home invasion, and he was beaten over the head with a hammer, and he had an abdominal wound and so forth. He was airlifted unconscious into hospital. Now, he had the most appalling events within coma, so bad that he says they were far worse than the actual home invasion. So he puts that down to, and his psychologist that he spoke to, put the appalling events down to what happened to him immediately prior. And then you've got other people who've just come out of a normal life, just suddenly, you know, they've collapsed in the street, say with a heart problem, and life's fairly normal, nothing is upsetting them. And they're equally having appalling nightmares. And the things they come up with, you know, there's Deborah in the book. If you say to Deborah, how long were you in your coma? In the terms of the hospital, I think she was about 3 weeks. If you ask Deborah, she would say, I was 80 years in my coma. And she lived an entire existence, and this is so strange, you can't make it up, as a living mannequin in a serial killer themed bar where nightly they reenacted murders, rapes, and all manner of horror on her night after night after night. And in that period, she gave birth to three children, and she was able to gauge the measurement of time. They're so strange. And she just came out of a fairly normal, happy life into that.
Now, did you look into, and I don't remember reading this in the book, did you look into whether or not such a place ever existed or exists?
Nick, for example, in his Midtown, it's kind of generic Midtown, Midwest, you know, America. There were certain features about it. The town produced an ice cream of a peculiar pink color, which he was very attracted to. Other than that, when he also said that it was very much like America, but not like America on a map. Things weren't in exactly in the right place. Things were just slightly different. And he also said, whereas our atmosphere is blue, the atmosphere in this alternate life was slightly orange. And I don't know what to make of this, but over and over, different people have told me about the color orange being a major feature within their coma. And that's,
do you suppose that we have parallel lives in another universe in which the atmosphere of the Earth is orange?
I certainly can't discount that. I mean, I've listened to some.
God, I mean, this is so fascinating.
This seems entirely likely. It seems entirely likely. But I think what we found here with Comas, it's like a gateway that no one's ever bothered to explore before. It just opens up to all these different worlds. Some we know, like the near-death experience. These nightmarish worlds are not like anything. Others go back in time, and they're having dinner with their family and tasting everything and joining in the conversation. And that's not like anything. And finding parallels is very, very hard.
Yeah.
There are mechanisms which we can talk about as to why certain things happen. For example, if you're experimenting with psychedelics, you can switch off a key part of the brain known as the default mode network. It regulates our conscious reality. The same thing happens in the deepest states of meditation. The network is switched off. It's been demonstrated to switch off within coma. And that leads to an expansion of consciousness. So people within a coma, when they're experiencing things, some of that can be explained in the same way that psychedelics can be explained, because the mechanisms are the same. Additionally, the human body produces its own psychedelic compound. I won't try and pronounce it, so I'll just call it DMT. Doctors can detect it in the system, but they can't find where it's produced, and they certainly can't explain why. If you look at the urine of people suffering from schizophrenia, they have high levels of DMT in their system. DMT is the active ingredient in the Amazonian mystic brew, ayahuasca. People that take ayahuasca are recounting the same events, similar events, to those of people within coma. It can also, and we've demonstrated in the book, DMT can be triggered by putting yourself into the deepest forms of sensory deprivation, which incidentally coma survivors are also in. When you monitor people within that situation, they're reporting very much the same events within coma. They are reporting nightmarish events. They're reporting exceptional beauty. And in some cases, they're revisiting past lives.
We're going to take a short break, folks. We'll be right back. Where is the unknown country? Is it out there, in the stars? Or is it also somewhere else? Is it in us, in you? Unknown country, join us today. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and join us. Join the questions. Join the search. Join the adventure.
unknowncountry.com. There's no place like it in the world. Have you ever read Communion? Or have you never read Communion? It's out in a new edition. Very powerful, a subtly new cover that reflects the fact that the visitors are now looking back at us because they truly are. You can get it from the unknowncountry.com store as a Kindle, as a beautiful, sumptuous paperback, or as an unabridged audiobook read by me. It's the first time in the whole life of Communion that it has been read in full in audio format, and believe you me, I felt that reading. I put my life, my memories into it, and I trust you can hear it in the voice. I sure felt it while I was reading. So get Communion, listen to it, read it. Communion is of central importance to all of our lives. So we're talking about what I think could be described as the releasing of the consciousness from the default mode network, which is where the ego is. And when that happens, it becomes loose in reality somehow, but it doesn't lose itself completely. There are lots of people, though, whose comas are just black. They don't remember a thing. That's correct, isn't it? Yes.
Yeah, it's impossible to say whether they're in the minority or the majority, because those people that I've managed to make contact with haven't tried to make contact because they had a blank in their lives that they're told to expect. They've tried to make contact with others because they've experienced these strange things.
Yes.
So it stands to reason I'm more likely to find them. But gauging that's almost impossible. Of the 20-plus coma survivors who helped us with the book, it's fair to say that two of them had proper blanks within their coma. Each, however, were left with problems. One physically, he's actually fine, which is remarkable considering all the other survivors I've spoken to. The other one, a female, had lost so much of her memory, just vast gaps, and just not knowing what had happened, you know, at her birthday last week, not remembering a single bit of it. And it varies so much for people.
Yeah, I'm just looking here. Let me see what the name of this chapter is. Just a second. I have a bunch of questions. The dark brings light, touching the void. And I think when I was reading that, this is saying the void isn't the void. It's something else. Can you expand on what you think is in there, in the sense that when you shut down the default mode network, you free the consciousness from the ego, and therefore from all of its assumptions and expectations about what the world around it is. Does that mean that it becomes free to simply imagine, or does it really go somewhere else, other places? Go ahead.
I don't think it's imagining. I think it really is. They really are going other places. I'll give you an example. We're talking of the psychedelic compound DMT. I spoke to a couple, a man and a wife, that took it together recreationally. And when they do so, they go to the same place together. A lot of people that do DMT one way or another report these entities, intelligent entities that they communicate with invariably telepathically. There's multiple types. One type, people sometimes call electric elves. These people call them tree elves. And there they were in the living room of their house. And one of these tree elves is playing with the record player and he's going to break it. And they're both watching that and they can both see it. Now, they've both gone somewhere. When people take ayahuasca, for example, the Amazonian brew, they're often going to realities that are virtually identical in terms of the experiences they have when they're there. They can't explain what it looked like. Sometimes they have no visuals. And also, it's what people say, it's ineffable. There are no words to describe these things. But clearly, they are going to the same place. When, for example, one doctor gave DMT to shamans in the Amazon who are familiar with ayahuasca, they said, these are the spirits we work with. We know this place. So, yeah, I think they're going somewhere.
No, excuse me. What do doctors, I know the brain, because I was with a coma victim. I lived with my wife. I slept, on, if you can believe it, on the floor of the hall outside the ICU when she was in her coma. And I wasn't alone. There were no wives out there, but a fair number of husbands. And because, you know, we want to protect our gals. And so what do they doctors, she was covered with leads, and there was a brain expert who would come and read her brain waves all the time, few hours.
That's unusual. That is really unusual.
It is.
Oh, well, yes, utterly.
Maybe it isn't in this country, but maybe they don't do it in England.
No. I mean, predominantly, my research took place in the US. But it's global.
So
no one
don't
has
actually
ever said that. No. When I spoke to Dr. Wes Ely, professor of medicine at Vanderbilt, he had put people on an EEG brain scanner and later in an MRI scanner. And he'd been horrified by what he'd seen. And he came to being the first he'd ever heard of people doing that. And by looking at people who'd been in coma for some time, he gave me the example of a young woman. I think she was like 35. She was a mathematical whiz. After her coma, she couldn't even add up her checking account. She took another IQ test and came up at 100 as opposed to 140. When Dr. Wes Ely put her in an MRI scanner, parts of her brain had shriveled. She had the brain of a very old woman with dementia. She was 35 or thereabouts. That's what he was seeing. When he was just reading the brain waves of people in coma, he was horrified how deep they were going, because they were effectively dead. You can't say brain dead, because that is something else, but their brain was effectively dead to the world, and that horrified him. And I don't think most doctors ever get the opportunity. In fact, I know for a fact doctors do not get the opportunity to do that. So why they were doing it in Anne's case, I can't even begin to imagine.
You know, I could be wrong about it, because my memories are not perfect about that time too, because of the trauma that was involved. It could be that they didn't start reading her brainwaves until after she, I remember now. She had brain swelling because of the blood that got into her brain from the stroke when she had the brain bleed, and the monitors were there to detect the level of what was happening to the brain, because they were doing this
that would make sense, because that's a specific issue that they're looking for.
So that was why
you
were there.
You had COVID, they would not be looking at that, for example.
Later, though, they took them off. That was when they put her into a really deep state. And that was when I think she had the near-death experience. Because they eventually took them off because the brain bleed was resolving normally. I mean, the swelling was resolving normally. And her, I don't know what her, I never asked what her brain state was, but she was still kept under sedation. because she was intubated for about another 3 weeks until the brain was completely recovered. Then she was disintubated and proceeded to have a fantastic case of ICU psychosis. It just started with her announcing that she didn't know who I was. And she was completely talking about another reality and all kinds of things that really didn't make sense. And the neurologist said to me and my son, he said, she's got to have 24 hours a day because she's not going to sleep for days. And you guys have got to spell each other. And every time she comes up with something that doesn't make sense, you have to tell her that. You have to read the newspapers, all of this.
Sorry. I'm so sorry. No, because automatically the default for a doctor here is not to look for any spiritual explanation. The automatic thing is to say it's a blip. They call it ICU delirium, ICU psychosis.
That's exactly what they call it.
Yeah, exactly. And they don't even understand what that means anyway, to be frank. It's a catch-all. It covers so many things.
She was terribly happy. I mean, she was talking about all these weird things.
Of course. And people do. But they dismiss it as if it was some form of mental illness. Whereas if somebody had a near-death experience, you and I know not to treat that as a mental illness. A doctor does not know to treat that as a mental illness. And this is the problem. They do not look for the explanations that we have discovered in this book. There are perfect explanations for how things are happening. The answer of why do we have a near-death experience? Why does Nick have an alternate life? These we cannot ever hope to explain, I imagine. But doctors have got to look beyond the simple dismissive things. You know, I read today that the events that people experience after coma, where their bodies don't work, where they've lost vast amounts of memory, rather than explore this in its own right, they're now marking this down as long COVID, even for people who didn't have COVID. And it's like how to brush something under the carpet and not explore the problems. In the book, we explain why people are getting the events that are happening. I don't know specifically about Anne's case, but what seems to happen in ICU, before they even put you in a coma, you are not getting sufficient sleep. No one in ICU gets sufficient sleep. You're lucky if you even get 2 hours a day.
That's three right. She was waked up every few minutes.
Yeah. 3 days of that, you go into massive sleep deprivation. This leads to acute brain failure. The longer you're in that state, the greater the damage that will be caused. Equally, if you're in a coma, you're not sleeping. Doctors call it sleeping, but your brain, because it's unplugged, is not going through its circadian rhythms. You are not getting REM sleep. No one is sleeping within a coma. Again, they're getting acute brain failure through sleep deprivation. This is just simply not understood. It's so easy to figure it out. You walk into an ICU unit, you say, how much sleep does this person get a day? They're not getting a good 6 to 8 hours. Therefore, they are going to be sleep deprived, but it's not treated that way. It's remarkable. And when you're in that state, you will imagine all manner of things. Reality, the world around you in the hospital, will weave into something your mind is doing and turn it into a horror show. Or a weird reality. One person told me, because they propped her up on a red cushion, she thought she was the Pope. And because everyone was looking at her with some kind of expectation, waiting on her every word, she really, really felt she was the Pope. people will get these delusions, but that's not a coma. That's just from being in ICU.
Well, that's what happened to Anne. She had that, but once she came out of it, the first thing she started talking about was the near-death experience. And that was, that, as I say, it changed her life. She would tell anyone who she felt was on the right journey about it. And she would always say, you have to put those burdens down in this life, because once you're on the other side, you can't. And of course, that means living a whole different kind of life. It means basically a self-examined life. And she used to say the one thing that the Western world said right, that we all ignore, is the motto on the wall of the temple at Delphi, know thyself. And but if you don't know yourself, you might not be able to go on. Interesting, isn't it?
It's all remarkable. For me, yeah, I feel like we've discovered something that no one has ever, well, I know this, no one has ever bothered to explore for the last 50 years when it's been medical practice. No one has ever bothered to explore it. And
you have
very quick to dismiss exactly. things. Well, we have, because it's taken a journalist, me, and a private investigator, my wife, B, to do what doctors or scientists should have done. They've not done it because modern critical care is now a conveyor belt of care, where no one's looking over their shoulder at the end product. They're too busy dealing with the next patient. And everyone's just shoved down the line into care facilities or whatnot. Often, they can't speak for weeks at a time because of damage to vocal cords from the ventilator. They wake up and they don't even know, who these people claiming to be their family are. It takes them a long time before they can then address any issue of a near-death experience. That, and then when they even begin to do that, they don't know where to start. Oh, by the way, hon, I've just had another husband and I've got three children that we didn't know about. It doesn't make sense. No one can openly say these things, so they keep them to themselves. What should happen? I'd like to see an end to prolonged deep sedation in ICU from here on. But if they were to continue it, or just to find the people that have been through the process, they need to debrief them. They need to explain to them what they've seen in terms of someone who understood an NDE should explain to them what they've experienced. Other people who've been through the coma experience should be allowed to talk to people fresh out of coma or people about to go into coma so they can tell them what to expect so they don't feel completely cut off and mad. That said, there's almost only a handful of instances where it's generally agreed coma is a good thing. Certain kinds of brain seizures, you want to switch the brain off. Certain injuries such as abdominal and after certain heart operations, complications. And even then, it's a trade-off because you're causing irreparable harm to the patient because of the steep deprivation. Simply one thing, we used to think that bed rest was the best thing. And it's been that way for thousands of years. We've all thought this. Modern medicine has discovered that just 1 week of bed rest can result in the loss of 40% of lean muscle in 1 week. And this is not noticeable in people in coma who've been there for, say, 2 to 3 months, because they're so pumped full of fluid, you can't see the muscle wastage. So it's small wonder they can't walk when they get up. And this is also damaging, and it turns out that it's not even necessary. There's no medical literature or scientific literature that advocates prolonged deep sedation ICU. All modern literature decries the practice with a vengeance. They call it lethal. They call it damaging, and they call for it to be stopped. Unfortunately, people don't seem to be paying attention. And they're not paying attention because they don't see the damage that they're causing.
Yeah, I can see that. Wait a minute. We have come to the end of the free part of the show. The show has a free part and a part that continues for subscribers. So we've come to the end of the free part of the show. And as always, I would like to thank those who listen to the free part only for joining us. I hope you enjoyed it. And when we get back... something has come up in my mind. Alan has brought up something that jogged a very old memory of mine when I was in the ICU and I had a past life experience that I've never spoken about before at all. And I'm going to run through that and see what you think of it and how it compares to other people who have had this same thing. So... Free Dreamlanders, thank you so much for being with us, and subscribers, we'll keep right on keeping on.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Anne Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.